This tiny teach is about bacteriophage replication. This tiny teach is going to cover both lytic and lysogenic viral replication. We're going to begin with lytic viral replication. Viruses are always very specific about the host cell that they use to produce progeny viruses in. In lytic viral replication, our bacteriophage is T4. It has DNA for its nucleic acid, and our host cell is E. coli strain B. Step one, attachment. T4 and E. coli would randomly collide, but then T4 would realize that this is the right host cell because it would bind to a receptor on the E. coli strain B. That binding of bacteriophage to receptor lets it know that this is the correct host cell. Step two, attachment. Our T4 bacteriophage wants to use the host cell machinery to make progeny viruses. To do that, it needs to get its DNA inside of the host cell. An enzyme called lysozyme is released. It begins to eat away at the E. coli cell envelope, and T4 injects its DNA into E. coli strain B. Step three, I'm going to combine these two steps together, and I'm just going to call it synthesis. T4 has injected its DNA into the E. coli strain B, and it wants to use that host cell machinery to produce progeny viruses. To make sure that that's all that happens, the T4 produces an enzyme that breaks apart the E. coli strain B chromosome. T4 does not want E. coli to transcribe and translate its E. coli DNA. That would be a waste of valuable time and resources. So by breaking apart the E. coli strain B chromosome, now T4 can actually use all of the host cell machinery to produce components. It's going to make copies of its DNA using the E. coli strain B host cell machinery and copies of its capsid or protein coat. Step five is assembly. The DNA of T4 is put inside of a capsid or protein coat. And then step six is release. The lysozyme enzyme has continued to weaken the cell envelope, and the E. coli strain B lyses and bursts open, and the progeny viruses, the T4s, are released. Now I'm going to cover lysogenic viral replication. Lysogenic viral replication begins and ends the same as lytic, but it has a different middle part to it. So in lysogenic viral replication, we're going to see virus and host cell specificity again. We're going to use lambda as our bacteriophage. It has DNA for its nucleic acid, and we're going to use a different strain of E. coli as our host cell. The first two steps, attachment and entry, are the same as we covered in lytic viral replication. So in this case, our lambda and our E. coli would randomly collide into each other. Lambda would know that this is the right host cell by binding to a receptor on E. coli, and then lysozyme would be produced, and the lambda DNA would be injected into the E. coli. Now we're going to come over to this part of the picture, and I'm going to actually cover steps three and four. I'm going to combine these two steps together into insertion and replication. So we have our E. coli host cell. It has its E. coli chromosome and the lambda DNA. What happens in step three insertion is the lambda DNA inserts itself into the E. coli chromosome. The E. coli is none the wiser, it doesn't mind. And every time this E. coli goes to divide by binary fission, it has to make a copy of its DNA. So you're going to get binary fission, and when the bacteria do that, they're going to replicate the lambda DNA right along with their own DNA, and you're going to end up with a lot of E. coli that have lambda DNA inside of their chromosome. Basically, lambda did this because it decided it wasn't a safe time to produce progeny viruses. There's something in the environment where the lambda says, hey, it's not safe to produce a bunch of progeny viruses and release them at this point. I'm going to hide my DNA inside the E. coli chromosome and sort of wait until the coast is clear. Step five is going to be induction. What happened here is the virus, Lambda, senses that this E. coli is in serious trouble, and this E. coli is actually going to die. So it needs to produce its progeny and get out of the E. coli with the progeny before the E. coli dies. Step 5 induction is triggered by things like exposure to x-rays, ultraviolet light, carcinogens. These are all things that would actually kill the E. coli host cell. So in step 5, induction, the lambda DNA removes itself from the E. coli chromosome, and then the E. coli chromosome is broken down into little pieces. Step 6, synthesis. Step 7, assembly. Step 8, release, are the same as what we covered in the lytic viral replication. So now lysogenic starts the same as lytic, and it ends the same as lytic. So in step 6, Lambda DNA would use the E. coli host cell machinery to produce copies of its DNA and capsids. Step 7, assembly. Lambda viruses would be actually assembled by putting the DNA inside the capsid. And then again, step 8, release. The E. coli host cell bursts, releasing the progeny viruses into the environment.